Namaste, Jai Shri Krishna, everyone. So, my essay in this book deals with Romila Thapar. Romila Thapar, as you know, is a very influential historian. She is like the godmother of all the Marxist historians. So I'll start. So, I'm not introducing her because I assume that most people know about her. So, these are the issues examined in my essay. So I try to critically examine Romila Thapar's views on the Islamic period of Indian history, then her theories related to Hindu dharma and her views on sacred Hindu texts like Ramayana and Mahabharata. And if time permits, I will discuss her theories on India and, you know, Hindu nationalism. So my inspiration for this essay is a video lecture series which Rajivji had given 2 years back, and which he had discussed, you know, critically examined Romila Thapar's methodology and called it a colonized approach to history. So my essay is largely based on what Rajivji had already said. So let's now begin. Romila Thapar on the Islamic period of Indian history. So her theory regarding the cause of invasions. So Romila Thapar, she says that, you know, most of the medieval rulers of foreign rulers of India, the Islamic invaders, they were not actually motivated by religious considerations. And all their actions, you know, regarding the non-Muslims of this country were usually prompted by economic considerations, or these were the things. So they were very greedy. That's why they attacked India. So this is a very prominent example, Somnath temple attack. And she has written a book also, a complete book, you know, 200-page book on Somnath. So she comes up with theories like, you know, Mahmood's raid on the Somnath and other temples were due to economic motives. That's the general pattern the Marxist historians follow. They try to see it everything through class struggle, you know, economic class struggle. So she says that his greed for gold was insatiable. So that is why he attacked, you know, some kind of psychoanalysis she has done of Mahmood Ghazni. So now then she says that, you know, this is one thing. First of all, she says that, you know, he was very greedy. That is why he attacked Somnath temple. Then next, she says that, you know, it was a very trivial matter. Hindus, you know, did not even remember it, you know, and this some Hindu Raja, he gave a grant also to some Arab trader. So it was a very trivial matter. It was not a big deal. So, you know, Hindus are just making a big deal out of it. It doesn't matter at all. And then she, you know, comes up, she tries to suggest that, you know, maybe the attack even never happened at all. I mean, you know, Hindus just made it up. So these are the three things she says in her book, Somnath, on Somnath temple attack. Now I will just quote a few, you know, interesting quotations by her. So she says the raid of Mahmood could not have been forgotten 200 years after the event if it had been as traumatic as it is currently said to be. And then she says, you know, she's saying, you know, it's, you know, it might not have happened. So this is, you know, she's trying to suggest this thing. And she's very clever. She never she never says anything directly. She will give you hints like these, you know, and try to, you know, insinuate that this might be the case. That this, so she is not based on facts. She will just, you know, give you hints. You know, this might could be the case. This could be the case, and that's it. Then she says that no mention is made of Mahmood's attack on the Somnath temple, which is strange, given the statement that the temple had deteriorated and needed renovation. This is puzzling for her. She says this is puzzling, as there are occasional references to the breaking of temples. Or was the looting of temple not such an extraordinary event, given that some Hindu rulers also attacked temples of those they had conquered? And she, I mean, she's trying to suggest that, you know, it was very common. Hindu kings also used to do that. So Mahmood was just, you know, doing the same thing. It was not something, you know, different. So this is her, from her book, I have quoted. Now in this text, Ibn al-Athir, he's a Muslim historian of 1230 CE, so quite 100 years after Mahmud's raid. So he says then when Yaminud-Dawla, how he addresses Sultan Mahmud, was gaining victories and demolishing temples in India, the Hindus said that Somnath was displeased with these idols, and that if it had been satisfied with them, no one could have destroyed or injured them. When Yaminud-Dawla heard this, he resolved upon making a campaign to destroy this idol. So basically, you know, Mahmud attacked, you know, because he was told that, you know, Shivji ki jo ye Somnath mandir hai, it's very powerful, you know. So he said, no, my God is more powerful. That is why I'll destroy. I'll show it to you by destroying this temple. So this was the reason, you know, it's mentioned in this text by a Muslim historian of that period. So Romila Thapar, she says that, you know, there are no contemporaneous account of Mahmood's attack, but there are. I mean, that is not factual. So like this poet Dhanpal in his Apabhramsh poem, which was the earlier version of Hindi, Apabhramsh, Satya Puriya Shri Mahavir Utsaha. So he states that Anhilwad, Sorat and Someshwar, so Someshwar was the earlier name of Somnath, were looted by Turks. So it's a 12th century text. Then in the 14th century Jain text, Vivid Tirth Kalpa, it's written that by Jina Prabhasuri, he mentions looting of Gurjar country, which again means Gujarat, by Ghaznavi, Mahmud of Ghazni. So there are textual references, you know, in the Hindu and Jain texts that, you know, this Somnath temple was attacked. Then second thing, she says that Hindu culture flourished, you know, during the Turkish and Mughal rule. So these are some of the quotations. Far from being victimized, Hindu culture flourished along with other cultures in these centuries. And she says that Madhva's Sarva Darshan Sangrai and Samay Sundar's Arth Ratnavali and Shayan's Shayanacharya's commentary on the Vedas, it was written during the Muslim period. So she says that, see, Hindu culture was flourishing, you know, why you Hindus are, you know, making a fuss about it. So then she says the bhajans of Meera and Surdas and the poetry of Kabir and Tukaram, as well as the many renderings of Ramayan, were all composed in this period. So this is her argument that, you know, so many texts were being written, then, you know, what's the big deal? You know, there was nothing wrong with the Muslim invasion. And then she says that during the medieval period, there was also an intermingling of Hindu and Islamic culture. And the best known example, according to her, is Drupad. And it is regarded as one of the finest form of Hindustani classical music. So she says that Drupad was developed during the Muslim period. So that's the contribution of Muslim rule to Bharat. Now let's come to the facts. So Shayanacharya, which she mentions, he was a Sanskrit scholar in the independent Hindu Vijayanagar kingdom. So I don't know why she is, you know, referring to Shayanacharya when, you know, she while talking about the contribution of Islamic rule to India. Then he wrote commentaries on Vedas under the patronage of Vijayanagar kings Bukkavan and Harihar. So there is no point in, you know, in attributing what he has written to some, you know, Tughlaq or maybe Akbar, her favorite. Now, then she again, Madhva, who wrote Sarva Darshan Sangrah. So he was a Shayanacharya's brother and he was also based in the Vijayanagar kingdom. Then this Jain writer Samay Sundar, he was, you know, he lived in Rajasthan and he traveled in different areas, some Barmer and Jaisalmer, which were, you know, outside the Mughal control, actually. They were ruled by, you know, some Bharti rulers at that time. Now, again, regarding Surdas, so she says that, you know, Mirabai and Surdas also composed their poetry during the Mughal period. But there is a very interesting discussion in the Vaishnav Vartas, which are in Braj Bhasha. And, you know, in that Vartas, it's mentioned that Akbar, you know, met Surdas only once. And, you know, Akbar asked Surdas ji that, you know, what do you want me to do? And this was Surdas ji's reply: from now on, never again summon me and never try to meet me again. So, I mean, there is no point in attributing, you know, Braj Bhasha poetry, Sur Sagar, to Akbar. I mean, there was no relation at all. But still she, you know, says that, you know, it was a contribution of Mughal rulers, especially Akbar. And again, Mirabai, as we all know, she was, you know, based in Marwad and Mirta. And they were, you know, again, not under the control of, the Turkish rulers at that time. So, 1498, she was born in 1498 and, you know, the rest of her period, it is before the Mughals invaded India, before, you know, Babur's invasion. So Mirta and Marwad were independent kingdoms at that time. So again, you know, there is no point in, you know, mentioning Mirabai while talking about, you know, some intermingling of Hindu and Islamic culture. Now let us come to Drupad. I don't know. I mean, she says that Drupad was the contribution of Mughal rulers. But Drupad is a very ancient form of Hindustani classical music, and it is the successor of Prabandhgan, and it was between 11th and 13th century. It enjoyed great popularity. And, you know, she never mentions about Raja Man Singh Tomar of Gwalior, who was the, you know, I think the most important person who should be mentioned when talking about Drupad, but not, you know, many people know about him. And the legendary musician Tansen, actually he was at the court of Raja Man Singh Tomar. And, you know, when Akbar attacked Gwalior and, you know, captured it, then he took Tansen also with him. So Tansen was already an accomplished musician, and, you know, a Drupad singer before the Mughal time. And then, you know, there were, especially in the Vaishnava tradition, there are a lot of, there have been a lot of acharyas who have been, you know, famous for Dhrupad music. So I mentioned some names, Shril Jeev Goswami Raghunath Das from the Gaudiya Vaishnav Sampradaya, and there was Swami Haridas also, who was the acharya of Tansen. So these were, and Vrindavan was a very prominent seat of, you know, Hindustani classical music, even much before the Mughal or Turkish invasion. So this, there is no point in saying that, you know, Dhrupad was something which, you know, came up suddenly due to Akbar or some Mughal ruler. That's not factual at all. It's totally incorrect. Now let's come to the what Mughal rulers were actually doing. So contrary to Thapar's claims, the Muslim rulers, instead of patronizing Hindu scholarship in Sanskrit or other vernacular languages, they were patronizing Persian. So there is an interesting quote, Amir Khusro. I mean, I'm sure everyone knows about him, and he was a very important person because he was, you know, close to six successive sultans during the, you know, during the Turkish rule. And he, in his one of his works, Nuh Sipir, written in 1318, he says that Arabic is the knowledge of learning, Turki is art, Persian is sweet, and all other languages are bad and worth nothing. So this is his opinion on other languages. So he likes only Turki and Persian and Arabic, and he doesn't mention, you know, Sanskrit or Avdi or Brajbhasha or, you know, Apabhramsh. So, and then Akbar, you know, Akbar is, you know, generally he is mentioned again and again that, you know, he was, during his time a lot of fusion happened, and, you know, he was very tolerant, and all these things are mentioned about him. But, you know, Akbar was the first actually ruler, Muslim ruler, who formally institute a position of Malik-ush-Shuara. So it's a Persian term, and it means poet laureate at the court. And this was to be awarded only to a Persian poet only. So, and the Akbar was patronizing Persian. I mean, there is no mention of Sanskrit as such. And then he also made Persian the official language of administration at all levels. And because of that, learning and knowledge and high culture began to be associated with Persian. So, if you speak Persian, you would understand very well. And if you are speaking Sanskrit or some Braj Bhasha, then you are some, you know, Gamar kind of person who doesn't know, some bumpkin. Now, let's come to Romila Thapar's views on Hinduism and Hindu epics. That's interesting, actually. So she has, you know, coined these terms. I don't know what exactly, you know, she has not clearly specified what does she mean by these terms. So she says Vedic Brahmanism, that's one term, and Puranic Hinduism. So she says, you know, Vedic Brahmanism is the evil thing. You know, it, in her view, it propagated the use of Sanskrit through elaborate rituals. Ye Karma Kandi, all these people were, you know, Vedic, where they were, you know, following Vedic Brahmanism. And then Vedic Brahmanism, when it infiltrated, you know, it went and tried to digest all the other, you know, indigenous cultures, then Puranic Hinduism emerged out of it. So Puranic Hinduism is a kind of compromise between Vedic Brahmanism and the local indigenous cultures of India, the tribal cultures, as she says. And Thapar believes that deities like Shiv and Vishnu were earlier marginal. Koi inko janta bhi nahi tha. Who are these Shiv and Vishnu? And then suddenly, because of this process of assimilation, they became prominent. And this transformation happened between the Gupta period and the first millennium CE. I've kept this thing in bold because these dates are very important. So before the Gupta period, no one knew about Shiv and Vishnu. According to her, they were just marginal. You know, some people in some remote corner might be worshipping them. But after that, you know, suddenly, you know, at the end of first millennium, these became very prominent deities. So now let's come to the facts. So Romila Thapar has this theory that, you know, if in the Vedas there are a large number of, you know, hymns dedicated to Indra, then it means that Indra must be the most, you know, prominent deity. So, you know, it's directly proportional to the number of hymns. The importance is directly proportional to the number of hymns. So maybe she has counted, you know, that, you know, the number of hymns for Indra are too many. So Indra is most important, and then Shiva and Vishnu, they are not that prominently featured in the Vedas. So they must be marginal, which is not correct actually as per the traditional way of looking at Vedas. But yeah, so this is what I mentioned. The larger the number of hymns to a deity in the Vedas does not necessarily imply that the deity is more important. Now, Taittiriya Aranyak of the Krishna Yajurved it says that Purush Sukta of the Rig Veda. So basically, in Purush Sukta, Supreme Being, the Purush, is equated with Virat Purush, is equated with Vishnu. So it's not that, you know, these are not mentioned by, if it is equated with the Supreme Being, I mean, how important could it get? I mean, what exactly should we ask for, you know, to judge the importance of some deity? And then, you know, if you look into Shvetashvatar Upanishad, so it's all about, you know, it equates the ultimate highest reality with Rudra or Shiv. So it's not that these deities are mentioned, and they are mentioned very prominently. They are the ultimate reality if you look into the Vedic literature. Now, these are the textual evidences. We also have numismatic and archaeological evidence to show that before the Gupta period, Shiv and Vishnu and Krishna, they were very prominent. So like, you know, even prior to the Gupta period, this Indo-Scythian ruler, Maos, I think it's a distortion of Mahesh, who ruled because they called themselves Maheshwara. Maheshwara means worshippers of Mahesh, Shivji. So in 1st century BC, he issued several coins. I will show the images also with Lord Shiva's image on them. And then, you know, Shak and Kushan rulers, they are very famous. You know, they issued a lot of gold coins with, you know, images of Shivji and Ma Parvati and Nandi. So there are so many coins from 1st century BC, from 2nd century BC. So, you know, saying that, you know, these deities became prominent after Gupta period or somewhere around, you know, from 480 to 1000 AD. So that's totally incorrect, not factual. And there is also a temple, you know, of Shunga period temple. So I have, you know, mentioned dates which these historians use. I actually don't agree with these dates, but I've used them because I want to, you know, I'm doing a Purva Paksha, so I should use, you know, what she thinks. So I've used the dates which she uses. So these are not my dates. So we have, you know, during the Shunga period, there is currently a temple in Andhra, Parshurameshwar temple. And, you know, it has a huge Shivalingam, and it belongons to 1st century BC. So Shiv was worshipped, you know, and it could be even older. That this is the date suggested by her. So she is contradicting herself, you know, because, you know, she's saying that they became prominent only after, you know, first millennium. So these are the coins showing Shiva. And you can see Nandi also, and you can see the trident also. And these are the Kushan coins. Then, you know, this is the Gudimalam Shivalingam, which I'm talking about. And this is from 1st century BC. Then talking about Vishnu worship before the Gupta period, I think most people would be aware of the Besnagar pillar in Vidisha, Madhya Pradesh. It is basically, you know, some Bhagavat worshipper called Heliodorus. He was a Greek actually. And there is a Besnagar, they also excavated and they found the foundations of a Vishnu temple also. And that pillar is actually Garud Dhvaj, which was always, you know, near the Vishnu temple. And then there are, you know, torsos and idols of Lord Vishnu from 2nd century BC, which have been found. And there is also a Niccolo seal by a Kushan ruler, Huvishk, and which was, you know, there was this British archaeologist, Alexander Cunningham. And that Niccolo seal shows God Vishnu holding his Gada, Chakra, you know, and other Shankh and Padma. So this is the Besnagar pillar belonging to the Shunga period. And this is the Niccolo seal. As you can see, that wheel is actually Chakra, representation of Chakra. And you can see conch and shell also if you look closely. And that person, you know, standing in submission is the Kushan ruler. So again, you know, these were prominent deities even before the Gupta period. So she's not factually correct when she says that, you know, their worship became prominent during after the first millennium CE. Then, you know, Varaha worship. So that's very interesting. She says that, you know, ye Varaha worship to Central India mein jo tribals the, they used to worship Varaha. And then, you know, Vedic Brahminism appropriated it and, you know, and made him an incarnation of Bhagwan Vishnu. And, you know, but again, this is, and this happened after 6th century CE. And it was a compromise between the tribal cults of Central India and the Puranic religion. But you again, you know, if you see Taittiriya Aranyak, you will find references to Varaha Avatar. And, you know, there are sculptures also, and there are images discovered, you know, Varaha holding Bhumi Devi. So, and which are, you know, these texts are thousands of years older than 6th century CE, as per her own estimates. So, you know, again, there is a contradiction in what she says. You know, she is saying that, you know, this became prominent only in 6th century CE, but there are references to Varaha, and not just minor references, you know, they are very prominently mentioned. and they are even, you know, considered avatar of Vishnu. So it was not something, you know, concocted later on by some, you know, evil Brahmins. There was this, you know, some goddess she has found, Ardosho. So this goddess Ardosho, it was adopted as Shri or Lakshmi. So Lakshmi ki bhi hum puja nahi karte the. It was adopted by some foreign goddess Ardosho during the Kushan period of 1st and 2nd century CE. Again, this claim is completely incorrect because Shri Suktam is a very popular hymn in the Rig Veda. And, you know, Shri Suktam, it, you know, it's mentioned that it's in the Rig Veda, and Rig Veda is, I mean, thousands of years older than 1st century CE. And even Shatpath Brahman, it mentions, you know, Lakshmi as the goddess of fortune and beauty. So there is no, this is not again, factually incorrect. And we have archaeological evidences also. I will show Bharut Stupa, it's in Madhya Pradesh. And there is a medallion from a railing post, and it shows Gajalakshmi, two elephants, you know, holding pots in their trunks, and, you know, and they are showering goddess Lakshmi with gold coins. So this belongs to 2nd century BC. So this is incorrect to say that, you know, some Ardosho was the goddess, you know, actual goddess, and then the Hindus turned into Lakshmi in the 1st century CE. So this is the medallion from Bharut Stupa in Madhya Pradesh. And as you can see, in the middle is Ma Lakshmi, and you can see two elephants also. So this is from, you know, this is earlier than 1st century CE. Then Thapar's claims on Shri Krishna. She has this theory that Shri Ram and Shri Krishna worship started after the Muslim invasion. So Hindus wanted some, you know, some king, you know, whom they could say, oh yeah, we had a very nice, you know, warrior kind of king. So after that, you know, they took up Ramayana, and, you know, and, you know, they made Shri Ram and Shri Krishna prominent. Earlier, no one knew about them. And she also mentions that, you know, Ramayana itself was written later on. It was not the actual composition of Valmiki. She also says that it was copied by some Buddhist Jatak, you know, Dashrath Jatak. It was copied by Valmiki from Buddhist Dashrath Jatak. This is what she says. So again, I will just talk about Shri Krishna. So Shri Krishna worship is very, very old. I mean, you know, even in Ashtadhyayi, Acharya Panini, he mentions about him. And according to her, Ashtadhyayi belongs to, again, 5th to 4th century BC. That is what she says, is the date according to her. Ashtadhyayi mentions about, you know, Vasudeva and Arjun. And they are mentioned together in connection for the derivation of words denoting their devotees. So, you know, Bhagwan and, you know, jo Bhakta hai. So during that, you know, they discuss about Vasudeva and Arjun. And, you know, if there is any doubt, then, you know, if you read the commentary written by Maharishi Patanjali, in his Mahabhashya, he clearly states that Vasudeva here refers to the worshipful one, the god. And then Bhagavat Vaishnavism was very prominent even in Afghanistan. There are coins issued, you know, showing Shri Krishna and Balram by this Indo-Greek king Agathocles. In the 2nd century BC. So all her claims that, you know, there were no Hindu gods before before the Gupta period. Actually, her theory is that it was only during the Gupta period that Hinduism as we see now was constructed. Earlier, it was no such thing, no deities, nothing, no Hinduism, no Hindu nation. And she talks about Bharatvarsha also. She says, you know, there was no concept of India or nation or anything like that. It was just a geographical entity, and there was no such thing as, you know, which is also not correct. So now Thapar's claims on bhakti sects. She says that bhakti tradition actually was inspired by Buddhism and Jainism, which is quite funny because, you know, as I will show you how it is funny. But she says that, you know, it was inspired by Buddhism and Jainism. So again, you know, she's trying to create a drift between the, you know, various, you know, Buddhism, Jainism and Hinduism, the various, you know, different variations of Sanatan Dharma. So she says that Hindus adopted it from Buddhism and Jainism. And then she says that the feeling of human inadequacy that became an important facet of the bhakti devotional sects would have owed more to the Buddhist ancestry than to the Vedic. So this is her claim. And then she vaguely also tries to suggest that Sri Ramanujacharya of Vishishtadvaita school, he was inspired by Calvinist Christians because his whole theory of prapatti and all is actually practiced in Christianity. Now, if we look into the Vedic hymns, so there are, for example, in Mundak Upanishad, there is a mention of human inadequacy in the attainment of moksha. So, Paramatma is not attained through mere rumination, nor through mere meditation, nor through much hearing. He is attainable by that individual whom this Paramatma chooses. The Supreme Self reveals his own form to such a one. So this is basically doctrine of Prapatti. It is not very prominently told to everyone, but this concept is there if you look into Hindu texts. So it is not that, you know, it was adopted from Calvinist Christians. Now, regarding Buddhism, so in Buddhist philosophy, there is no permanent entity. There is this concept of Kshanikvada. In Kshanikvada, they say there is no permanent entity. So there is, everything is Kshanik. It keeps on changing every moment. So when I came on this stage, I was a different Anurag, and now I am a different Anurag. I am a totally different person now. So there is no Jivatma, because Jivatma has to be permanent. And there is no Paramatma, because again, it has to be permanent. And this is the doctrine followed by all the four philosophical schools of Buddhism. So when there is no Jivatma and there is no Paramatma, I don't understand how can there be a concept of Bhakti, because Bhakti is between Paramatma and Jivatma. But still she says that, you know, Bhakti was copied by Hindus from Buddhism and Jainism. So which is, that is why I was saying it was very funny, you know, to see this. Again, she says that, you know, this concept of moksha through anugraha, divine grace, I've used the word divine grace, but the Sanskrit term is anugraha. So she says that, you know, it was also copied from Christianity or Islam, or, you know, she has all kinds of theories. But again, you know, this concept is also there in the Katha Upanishad. I just want to say that, you know, I have provided her theories and then the facts according to our texts. So this has been the whole flow of my presentation. So thank you everyone for listening to me. Jai Shri Krishna.